Hi, this is Greg from Jedham's Astro. Today we're going to do something slightly different. We're going to review an antique refractor. So we've got a Broadhurst and Clarkson 3-inch refractor. And it's around about 100 years old, and we're going to take a look at its features and see how it performs. Another novelty, aside from looking at an old scope like this, is that we're going to use a piece of furniture in the video. So the table itself is going to feature, and there's a reason for that. We need a table, and certainly a table when we're outside, because this telescope is a little bit diminutive in terms of its mount. It's a library telescope and comes from an era when people may have had a library and they'd like to look out the window, both at terrestrial viewing and look at the stars. And they did so from the comfort of their home and with a mounting like this. So everything a little bit different today. We're going to look at the scope, and then we're going to judge how well it would have worked. So let's take a look over the scope. At the business end is an achromatic doubler. This one has a clear aperture of 76 millimeters or 3 inches in old money. And I'll say that the focal ratio is around F12, maybe slightly longer. It has no discernible tint on the lens, so I assume that it isn't coated. There aren't any screws to adjust the lens cell on this particular scope. You see that on some other ones of the period. And there's no separate dew shield. Basically, the lens cell is recessed maybe five centimetres inside the tube. So that forms the dew shield. Some other scopes at the same sort of time have a detachable dew shield. And if we look inside the tube there with a torch, hopefully you can see that there are a series of baffles inside the tube. The paint inside is a little bit slapdash, but heck, it is black, so hopefully we shouldn't have too much of a problem with stray light. The tube is made of brass and it's painted black with what's known as crackle paint or wrinkle paint. Hopefully you can get an idea of the finish if I, again, shine a torch along the tube. There's a couple of places where this one's been touched up, but overall the finish is pretty good. I think the original paint is lead-based, and the finish is more to do with how the paint is allowed to dry, I believe. This one's in pretty good shape. There's only one small dent on the tube. A lot of scopes you see 100 years old or so have got quite a lot of damage. I'd say one of the nicest features of these old scopes has to be their focusing mechanisms. So this one and this one, the external knob acts on a rack that's mounted inside the tube. And you can easily access the rack by taking this plate off, and you can grease the rack. But it gives a really smooth motion, and it makes a very pleasing sound. I'd say it's as smooth as many, many modern focusers have come across. Probably the only downside is that it doesn't have a way of adjusting the focus of tension. But really, that's perhaps a feature of modern scopes, where you're hanging a lot of maybe astrophotography kit, heavy eyepieces, heavy cameras. You have to remember that this sort of scope would have had a much lighter weight set of eyepieces like this one. So the problem that you'd face with the focus of tube moving when the scope's pointing upwards really wouldn't have been a big deal at all. So aside from the fine adjustment that you get with a focuser, scopes like this also contain another tube, another draw tube that can be pulled out like so. And the overall effect is that you've got a very wide range of focusing ability. So you can use this particular scope, for example, to focus down to around 30 feet. And you've got to remember, this is advertised as a library telescope, perhaps for terrestrial viewing. And obviously in that context, it's important to be able to to reach focus on objects that are relatively near. And on the topic of the draw tube, this scope has got what's known as an RAS thread. So the eyepieces, say like this one, the original ones would have been brass, but basically these eyepieces, they thread into the back of the draw tube. So none of the modern compression rings or friction bolts. So these simply screw into the back of the draw tube. You can see on the plate here, we've got the name Broadhurst Clarkson & Co. and the address 63 Farringdon Road, London. That dates the scope to after 1908 when the company moved to those premises, but it's difficult to be more precise beyond that. There's no serial number, but I would guess around 1920, but it could be a little bit either side of that. And then finally, the mounting. So there are two common types of mounting for this sort of scope. One is for a library telescope, as they're called, like this one is a so-called pillar and claw. This is a really heavyweight piece of kit, and the legs retract, so you can fold up the whole assembly. And even though, as we've noted, you can only use this sort of scope up to a certain elevation, it's actually quite a solid mounting arrangement, certainly when you're not outside. So if you were using this in a library and you're looking out of a window, a terrestrial object, then you can easily pan around, nice smooth movement, and the scope holds any elevation that you might set. So the pillar and claw is attached to the tube with two bolts, and on some other scopes you'll see that they are attached to a more conventional field tripod arrangement, and often they have a pivot through the tube here instead. Okay, so what else is there to say? The only thing is I've got an eyepiece adapter which converts the RAS thread into a standard 1¼ inch. Now, in general, if we're going to assess the quality of the objective, I think we need to have the ability to use modern eyepieces, and certainly using this scope visually, I struggle with some of the old Ramsden type eyepieces, because I wear glasses, and certainly the eye relief of those is not really comfortable for me. So pretty essential and very handy to have an adapter, just so that we can get slightly more into the modern world when it comes to eyepieces. So the next and most important thing is to see how it performs. Any scope that I review on Jennings Astro, most important thing is the quality, because it's not really about just looking at the scope, although that's quite nice. Really, optical instruments are designed to be used. So we're going to see if we can gauge the quality of the optics. So any telescope's only as good as its objective lens. And in order to have a look at the quality of this one, I've put hand-holding a digital SLR over the back of the focuser draw tube. And we're looking at the moon, and I guess it's pretty obvious to see that we're getting a nice crisp image, no major issue there. I'd like to have connected the camera directly into the adapter that I've got, the 1¼ inch adapter, but I found that I can't reach focus, so that's why the image is a bit wobbly, but that's a small point. So I've put an ASI 120MC camera onto the back of the scope, and we're just letting the moon drift through the field of view. I think you can see that the image quality is actually pretty good. One thing I'd say is that it's very difficult to move the mount without losing the moon. It's a bit like using probably the wobbliest telescope mount you've ever had, maybe one of your first telescopes. But taking that aside, if there isn't any wind, then I think it's got some good optics. If I try and demonstrate the focuser, then it causes the image to wobble a bit, but coming back into focus,
it's pretty good.
And then finally, let's see how it performs during the day.
So looking at some of the nearby foliage, I'm getting a nice clear image. This is around 10 meters distant from the scope, so you can see the near focus works pretty well. And I'd say the contrast is also quite good. If we practice with the focus, we can see it's quite easy to achieve a good focus. And if we're patient enough, we might even see a bullfinch. I'd say the optics are pretty good.
So, conclusions. Overall, I'm very impressed with this scope. Optically, it performs very well, certainly compares well with other 3-inch refractors that I've used. Really nice, solid feel about it. Carrying it around, you feel that it's, if not indestructible, it's certainly quite robust. Really like the focuser, especially if you can adapt it to use modern eyepieces. So that's all really a good experience. This mount is probably the weak link, certainly we've seen. Outside, it's very tricky to find and track objects. And obviously, if you're using high magnification, the drift out of field view, you can waste a lot of time reacquiring the target. So definitely, this is one to be used on a more modern mount, and that should be pretty easy to adapt with a set of tube rings and a dovetail connection. So that's what I plan to do. Plan to use the scope, and now that I've seen that it's got good optics, certainly want to use it regularly and take advantage of something that's 100 years old, but definitely got a lot of life in it yet. So, Broadhurst and Clarkson 3-inch refractor, nice piece of kit. Okay, thanks for watching.